It is the early morning, and the working day of the steam locomotive and its crew is just beginning. The golden age of the steam railway was built on foundations of hard work, on skilled work, on dedication. How often are steam locomotives described as being alive, as more animal than machine, as living, breathing creatures? Creatures, machines, that have personality. Just like living creatures, locomotives need tending, feeding, watering, and grooming. The working day of a steam locomotive begins early with a full ritual of preparation before taking to the road. Fires to be lit, steam to be raised, with feeding and watering. The joints and tendons through which pass the locomotive's power and strength need to be lubricated and exercised. Light oils and heavier greases for the running gear as metal slides up against and over metal at high speeds. Heavy oils for the cylinders designed to atomize under the heat and pressures of the locomotive to become microscopic particles flowing into the cylinders and valves along with the steam. The smell of the emulsified oil and steam mixture giving rise to one of the distinctive sensations of the steam railway. In the golden age of the steam railway, the steam locomotive reached its greatest ever level of technical sophistication. It was a time when the art of locomotive design attained its greatest achievements. And it was a time when some lucky passengers were carried in incredible comfort and style. The era of railway history begins in the aftermath of the Great War, when the multitude of British railways, large, small and tiny, were struggling to recover from both the ravages of war, when the system was overworked, and face up to the great hardships of the 20s, which were beginning to bite. The government looked to rationalise the system, and in 1923 had created four new companies, the Big Four. The Southern Railway is perhaps one of the less fanatically admired by today's enthusiasts, yet it presents a fascinating picture. Its role in the economy was a carrier of people, more than a carrier of freight. The Southern network was a key part of the commuter-based world of the southeast of England. In this, the Southern was perhaps more like a modern railway than the rest of the Big Four. The Southern was a railway which looked outwards to Europe and the world, linking to France with cross-channel services and the great ocean liners through Southampton. The London and North Eastern was formed from the railways which ran up the East Coast all the way to Scotland. Its trains served the rural depths of East Anglia and much of northern industrial England. The LMS, the London, Midland and Scottish Railway, was an amalgamation of already large railways to form the largest single railway system in the world. Its lines ran into almost all parts of the British Isles. LMS trains penetrated the farthest reaches of the Scottish Highlands, the West Country and Bristol, the industrial Midlands, and above all, served the West Coast route to Scotland. The Great Western was less of an amalgamation, having retained an identity founded in 1840. It ran fast trains from Paddington over lines laid down by Brunel. It bore the produce of the agricultural West Country to London. The GWR also had a dirty industrial face, covered in the grime of the South Wales coal fields. Its continuity of tradition made the Great Western distinctly aloof to trends and fads. The Great Western's engines retained a distinctive style. Its coaches, the definitive chocolate and cream livery. The world of the Big Four was the world of the classic steam railway. It was a different place to that which we know today. This film from the late 1920s was shot from the Flying Scotsman Express on its run from King's Cross. Its journey is a slice right through the world of classic steam railway. This was a time when you could tell where you were just by the type of coach on which you rode. King's Cross is being left behind by a rake of the distinctive teak stock of the LNER. A pattern and style inherited from the older Great Northern Railway. The engine is an A3 Pacific, one of the first of the big new express classes that were to become icons of this era in railway history. The express speeds through a station. Past center balance semaphore signals, typical of the former Great Northern sections of the LNER. Some distance from London, the train picks up water from troughs necessary to ensure non-stop running. The fireman would lower a scoop under the tender, and the speed of the train would force thousands of gallons up into the tanks, often washing the coaches of the train at the same time. Further north, and the design of the signals have changed, telling us we are now in the part of the LNER that was formerly the territory of the old Northeastern Railway, one of Britain's smaller but richer railways. The track landscape was much busier and cluttered in these times. Here, the express travels past sidings servicing factories and goods stations. The railways played a far more important role moving freight and goods. This tangled weave of tracks with forests of signals and even a signal box perched up out of the way over the rails show us a time when more trains had separate locomotives and trains were far more often broken apart and recombined in complicated shunting operations. It was a time when locomotives needed servicing and refueling far more often. Track arrangements had to be more complicated just to make all these movements possible. This was a time when small rural communities saw the railway as their main link to the outside world. And the great industrial cities such as Newcastle depended on the railway for their economic lifeblood. The train overtakes goods traffic past a mixture of wagons privately owned and belonging to other railways. In some ways, it is the railway's role as a mover of freight that has changed the most since the classic age of the steam railway. Express carries on to the north of Scotland. In a time when the steam locomotive lives on only in preservation and living museums, as cherished and venerated objects cleaned, looked after, photographed and videoed, as a thing to be wondered at, puzzled by and scared of, it is fascinating to see the world of the classic steam railway, where steam was every day and nothing to be excited about. This view of the approaches to London on the LNER in the early 30s presents a sharp contrast to the living museum. Locomotives, perhaps not the cleanest, hustle back and forth with regular, ordinary, everyday trains at which no one is staring, pointing, or getting excited in the least. Expresses were such a major feature of the interwar years. There were far more expresses in those times, non-stop trains between the major cities. Today, we have almost no true expresses at all. Amazingly, for a smaller country as Britain, the Plymouth to Paddington and King's Cross to Edinburgh journeys were rated the longest non-stop runs in the world. The design of new locomotives was a subject of great public interest. Locomotives were stars. They went on tours of the United States and featured in cinema newsreels.
5,000 people are here to view the Royal Scot, England's crack train en route to Chicago for the World's Fair.
Now, cheerio, everybody, right away. We're up on our tours.
The LMS Royal Scot was in fact a borrowed design from the Southern Railway. Here is a close southern relative. A second look of the Royal Scot shows the family resemblance. It was the express routes to Scotland where the LMS and the LNER competed head to head, competing with both trains and public relations.
This is Britain's most powerful engine, built by the London, Midland and Scottish Railway for hauling the heavy Scots train between Euston and Glasgow.
The maiden journey of the new locomotive on the LMS Scottish Run. The engine has been named after Her Royal Highness the Princess Royal, and she is expected to break all records.
When the first 100 miles per hour journey was made is debatable. The GWR had a claim, but the first indisputable ton was only achieved by LNER A3 Pacific 4472 Flying Scotsman in 1934. In the interwar years, the science of aerodynamics brought a new understanding of the way in which air flows over surfaces, either aiding or hindering speed. The new knowledge began to be applied to other technologies, including locomotives, and was turned into an aesthetic. To be streamlined was to be at the cutting edge of style and fashion. But the new locomotives were streamlined on the inside, owing most of their power and speed to the application of the new scientific principles to the design of their arteries, their internal steam circuits, rather than their glamorous casings. In truth, the external streamlining was mostly a style statement. The streamliners of the LNER and the LMS were the products of an intense competition between the two railways, which had routes of similar length between London and Scotland, and which lent themselves to high-speed non-stop running. It was a competition which, of course, went back to the very start of railways in this country. It is important to separate competition in terms of technology, a battle of invention and innovation, and competition in terms of public image, what we would call today the PR war. It mattered just as much which railways trains were thought of as the best as which railways trains were the best. Were these splendid engines the triumphs of British technology, which they are so often called? It's hard to say. The British designers Stanier of the LMS and Gresley of the LNER made extensive use of new scientific theories of locomotive design developed by French engineers, in particular André Chapillon. These ideas lay beneath the skin of the locomotives. They were changes which gave the locomotive a bigger heart and bigger lungs. It was not just the locomotive, but carriages which were built to new standards of comfort and design, air-conditioned and double-glazed, with cocktail bars and hairdressers. The LNER and the LMS competed to hold the world speed record, leapfrogging each other with ever higher speeds. The LNER actually called its new trains high-speed trains, predating its modern use by 40 years. It was in July 1938 that the LNER achieved the record of 126 miles per hour, which still stands. It was not a scheduled service. It was a special test train on a Sunday on a downhill length of the straightest track the LNER possessed. The outside observer would not have known a world record was being set. It was the test equipment on the train which showed that Mallard held this top speed for a distance of only 185 feet. And what was the LNER actually testing? Improved brakes. Brakes that were needed to run at high speeds. While a streamliner held the ultimate highest speed record, the fastest journeys with ordinary, everyday scheduled services, trains people actually could travel on and would actually want to travel on, as world record runs tended to be rather uncomfortable, if not rather dangerous. The fastest everyday journeys were made by the old-fashioned looking locomotives of the Great Western Railway. Their quaint looking locomotives took advantage of easy routes and long stretches of flat straight track to make the fastest average journey times, a product of Brunel's excellent civil engineering nearly 100 years before. The PR machine of the Great Western turned rather obscure express trains such as the Cheltenham Flyer into some of the most famous services in the world by merit of the high overall journey speed. Great Western locomotives were not quite as old-fashioned as they looked. They may have looked rather Victorian with brass and copper rather than chrome and silver, with cabs that engine men found uncomfortable, but underneath they shared many of the inventions that made their more sleek and streamlined competitors so powerful. The Great Western was a very stylish railway. The GWR invented retro style before the term was ever used. Its locomotives had a continuity of design that lasted nearly the whole life of the railway. It's important to put the streamliners in perspective. Most of the British railway system was run by locomotives that were old in 1930. In 1939, the speeds of the LNER's non-streamlined services were not much faster than in 1913. The everyday train that did not get into the newsreel belonged to a world that had a different idea of distance to that we know today. Then there were no long-distance commuters as today. Even from towns in today's terms as close as 200 miles, the first trains might not reach London much before midday. Trains were not crowded. There was a vast oversupply of seats. For some cities, there were as many as five different competing routes from London. Not having a compartment all to yourself was regarded as a hardship. Trains were longer and heavier than today. 15 coaches were not unusual. Thank you. Stepping down in the railway hierarchy, a cross-country stopping passenger train calls at a rather quiet rural station on the Great Western. The locomotive is a 440 with a train of, what else, rather old-fashioned Great Western coaches. If many of the grander express trains were of what today would be unusual lengths, in rural areas, on country branch lines, services might be made up of just a locomotive, perhaps a small tank engine, and a few coaches. Here, somewhere on the LMS, an 060 Jinty hurries by with its train. But one wonders just what happened on this day, as an S15 460 makes light work of a two-coach southern train. It is the rural service which has perhaps disappeared most from the British landscape. The typical sleepy country station with a handful of trains visited by a stopping goods service which would pick up perhaps just one wagon could not survive in any form into the present day. Here, one of the smallest classes of Great Western engine brings its single coach train into what looks like the branch of a branch. All over the country, on all the railways, these small trains potted back and forth on picturesque routes, helping to knit together a world where people did not have second homes in the country. A sight which is lost to the depths of railway history is the destination board and the through coach. Trains will be made up of coaches for different destinations, each labelled with a board above the windows. The train would separate into parts, which would then be recombined, perhaps braking and joining several times, until the passengers reach their ultimate destinations. If today's long-distance commuter did not exist, the ordinary commuter certainly did. Here, an LNER steam commuter train arrives. Commuter service and steam do not go together. Engines which are only needed at peak times, yet have to be kept fired all day, are not economic. The electric train, which only costs when it works, is an obvious improvement. This view of the approaches to London Bridge show that the Southern Railway was the very first of the big four to make the big decision to make a huge investment in a major electrification, building new trains and laying supply the whole length of the line. The advantages of electric power on suburban commuter services are obvious. Electrification meant that on the southern lines into London, the railway was able to run twice as many trains in the 15 years between the wars. This increase in service was both caused by and the cause of the growth of the southeast, whereby the suburbs feeding London seemed to extend many miles from the capital. Perhaps the first sign of the end for steam was the first electrified main line, on the southern, the line to Brighton. In the classic age of the steam railway, special trains, non-scheduled services at holiday time, or to a special event were far more common. Today, football supporters travel by car or coach. In the past, these journeys were made by train. During the interwar years, people first gained the legal right to paid holidays. Blackpool alone, in the 1930 season, received 22,000 trains carrying over 3 million passengers. This doubled to over 6 million by 1935. This massive summer demand might at first seem a good thing. In fact, it was a burden, as the railways had to store and maintain a huge reserve fleet of carriages and locomotives, only earning revenue a few months a year. Less than a third of the total rolling stock was in everyday use. The expresses of the Southern connected to Europe. The Golden Arrow crossed the Channel to become the Flèche d'Or. other southern trains connected with the great ocean liners at Southampton. The famous night ferry was an ingenious sleeper train which was loaded completely onto a special ship. The passenger could go to sleep in London and awake in Paris. A railway's identity was not simply its characteristic locomotives and carriages. Every smallest detail was typical, and undoubtedly one of the most atmospheric and attractive features of the steam railway was the signalling. The sound of bells and the crash of levers echoing down onto a station platform is one of the most evocative experiences of the railway past. Each railway had its own characteristic design of signal box equipment. The cleanliness of the signal box with spotless interior seems a direct contrast to the grimy, smoke-laden exterior world of the locomotive. The signalling equipment represented in its time the cutting edge of technology. It could be argued that there has been little progress, that there is no improvement later technology could bring that would radically improve the safety of mechanical signalling. The end of the mechanical signal box has just made signalling cheaper and less labour-intensive, not better. The eye can delight in identifying a signal as the product of a particular railway. These pressed steel signal arms mounted on a latticed post are characteristically southern. Just as this gantry bears the signature of the Great Western, as does its signal box. One of the major safety concerns in operating a single track line is of two trains travelling in opposite directions. Careful, methodical working on the part of the signalman was not regarded as enough to ensure safety, and a technical answer was needed. This problem was solved by the invention of the token machine. The token was a bar, often shaped like a giant key, permitting a train to enter a section of single track. The tokens are locked into a system so that only one token can be released at a time, and so only one train on the line at a time. This gives rise to one of the picturesque sights of the steam railway, that of signalmen and firemen exchanging tokens. So, this is a Great Western signal box. Now, for a railway which in so many ways was defiantly old-fashioned, the Great Western was one of the advanced in terms of safety. And in the 1930s, it invented and protected all its mainline routes with an automatic train control system, here methodically explained by one of the railway's drivers.
This invention is called the automatic train control and makes travelling much safer. It also avoids much delay during foggy weather. When the signals are at danger, the siren blows thus. Which automatically brings the train to a standstill. When the signals are in the all right position, the bell rings thus. Both the siren and the bell are worked by a shoe fitted to the engine which comes in contact with a ramp fixed to the permanent way.
The steam railway, of course, ran on coal. Locomotives visibly consume their fuel. There is no silent falling of a gauge. The fuel is consumed before the eye. This feeling that the machine is eating is one of the things that makes locomotives have personality. When at rest, the fire burns steadily. When at speed, working hard, the fire roars as the locomotive sucks a powerful blast of air through the fire and the coal bursts into flame almost as it leaves a shovel. What makes good coal? Coal, which is small and full of dust, will be wasted blowing straight out of the chimney without burning, but over large lumps will burn unevenly, steaming inefficiently. Even the way coal is stored is important. Hard coals exposed to the weather break up and crumble, and much of the energy value simply evaporates slowly away into the air. Now the fireman's job varies from engine to engine. The box of this tank engine is comparatively small. But those of the largest locomotives, here an A4 Pacific, were giant expanses of flame representing a titanic task to the fireman. A job for the fit and the strong. The fireman's job is not simply to shovel coal, but to maintain the supply of steam, involving a constant monitoring of boiler pressure and water level. A splendid way to travel, but it was not efficient. At best, only a quarter of the energy available was actually used to boil water. It was a steam-driven world, where it was a major job of the railway to ensure the flow of the vital coal. In this scene of a privatized railway delivering the product to privatized mines, a vast array of wagons and trucks stuns the eye. What is now the job of the van and lorry delivering the individual load and the small consignment was the job of the stopping goods train, where small loads were picked up from the smallest and most local of stations and from a multitude of private sidings attached to factories and dispatched around the country. Individual wagons would be shunted and sorted, joining and leaving several different trains, until eventually arriving at another small and local station. The goods train will be a colourful and varied assembly that combined wagons from different places, from different railways and different industries, a sight that was never quite the same twice.
Sure, come on, Phil.
It was in goods transport that the railways first began to face stiff competition. The fact that railways had to work under legal restrictions with prices set by the government, laws dating back from the 19th century, a time when they had a monopoly of goods transport, meant that road haulage had an unfair edge. In the late 30s, a campaign was begun, Fair Play for the Railways. In this 1939 newsreel, the chairman of the LMS, Lord Stamp, argues his case.
Station entrances and hoardings in Britain have been placarded with arresting slogans during the past fortnight. Perturbed by the ominous words, we asked Lord Stamp what it was all about. He told us that there had been a 5 million drop in railway receipts this year. It seems that the terms on which railways operate were fixed 100 years ago, before there was any road transport to challenge their supremacy. Road transport, which has become so efficient in recent years, is not bound by the limitations which Parliament put upon the railway monopoly of those early years. So despite the strenuous efforts made by the railway systems to meet competition by new rolling stock, improvement of services and acceleration of time schedules on the long runs, they still find themselves handicapped by the regulations devised all those many years ago. Having seen the arrival at Euston of the Coronation Scot, in case you wondered what train it was, we'll have a final word from Lord Stamp.
Our receipts are dropping alarmingly. Matters are urgent. Prosperous railways are essential to prosperous commerce, and therefore to a prosperous nation. They could not be ready to help in wartime if they are weak in peacetime. All we are asking for is a square deal, a fair field, and no favour.
In 1939, with Europe once more on the edge of a world war, Britain's railways presented a story of mixed fortune. The PR department of the LMS was hard at work sending another locomotive on an American tour.
Good luck by Lord Stamp.
Well, goodbye, Bishop. You've had plenty of good advice, so I won't give you any more. But you're going over and we know you'll uphold the credit of Britain and British Railways. Goodbye to you too. Goodbye.
The train will shortly leave Southampton for its journey across the Atlantic. On the other side, a tour will be made embracing over 3,000 miles and 38 cities. The Americans will be able to compare the efficiency and luxurious appointments with those of their trains. After the tour, the Coronation Scot will be on show for 6 months at the New York World's Fair.
It is possible to argue that if speeds and frequency of services were considered, 1939 Britain had the best passenger services in the world, and that Britain was one of the most railwayed countries in the world, with more lines, more services, and more journeys per head than any other. On the other hand, a process of decline had already begun, with a constant grinding pressure of competition from road transport, which in many ways had inevitable and natural commercial advantages over the railway in the carriage of freight. Many rural lines were slipping into the long, slow journey that was to lead to the nemesis in the 1960s. Technology was advancing, building on the great progress made in the previous 20 years. Both the LMS and the LNER were planning new classes of express locomotives to replace the 462, again looking to follow French practice with bigger arrangements, 484s and 482s. Those locomotives would never be built. In 1939, the railways, just as much of Britain, were about to embark on what was to be their finest hour.